Professor Amanda House is a commissioner with the South African Commission for Gender Equality, also chairing one of the sessions this afternoon. Good afternoon to you, Professor.
Good afternoon.
What do you expect is going to come out from the session that you are chairing today? What's going to be your focus?
Well, it's the session of the International Women's Network, and the session is on safer cities for women. There will be representatives of different cities in the world talking about the issues of women and safety in cities. And I hope that there will be some resolution and how to go forward integrating women's needs about safety into new methods of urban planning.
And what are the needs?
Well, I think that if you look at, in our case, for example, but I've looked at the papers and it's the case in most cities, very high levels of gender-based violence against women. And if we just take something as mundane as transport, for example, unless you have transport that takes into consideration what happens to women when they get off public transport, the roads they have to walk, if it's lighted, if it's not, do they feel safe? I mean, there's a suggestion in the UN Habitat for Humanity's Women's Safety Program that political leaders just do a safety walk with women. Look where they go at night and what happens to them. So, yeah, I think it's about transport, it's about lighting, but it's also about broader issues like poverty and unemployment. You know, you get socially excluded and dislocated when you're poor, when you don't work. Very often these people who are, and specifically women who are unemployed, end up on the fringes of the city where it's more dangerous. So women have specific needs in that regard.
Well, we talk of caring cities. Really, do our cities in South Africa take care of the needs of our women?
Well, in this morning's session, there was a lot of talk about the programs that cities have, and specifically the city of Johannesburg, and how it has attempted to improve conditions for all people. But that there are also a lot of challenges with urban infrastructure, and ways of having to change the infrastructure and to create open and safe spaces, to create spaces for leisure so that people don't get into crime and gang violence and so on. So there are attempts, but I think what these programs show us is that there are a need for a multi-pronged approach to urban planning that takes into consideration infrastructure, but it also takes into consideration economic issues such as employment and unemployment, and then a social development that takes into consideration why people are socially excluded. How do you deal with issues of education, educating kids to get them out of crime? There was a wonderful paper this morning by in Mexico, where they've built parks. They call them knowledge parks, but it's huge buildings where kids can come and work on computers and so on. And that's really reduced a lot of entrance into crime for young kids and students. So it's also looking at social issues and how to deal with issues that actually contribute to danger in cities.
So there's just not one solution. We have to look at a multitude of solutions.
No, it's not a one solution fits all. And what's come out very clearly this morning is that even though we have global programs, they have to be contextualized in the local context, and all context differs. So we have to take those programs and adjust them to our needs, and specifically the needs in Africa, where there's a huge drive towards urbanization. By 2030, about 69% of the population in Africa will live in cities. And the argument is we shouldn't see urbanization as a problem. We need to see it as a solution to bringing people into the economy.
Let's take the Stop Rape campaign. It was very prevalent in South Africa a few weeks ago.
The 1 billion rising.
The 1 billion rising, and we had Anine Boysen in the in the Western Cape. What does local government do to tackle issues like the rape problem, the abuse problem? Do you see a role for them?
Well, now I think local government has a very important role to play, but we have to also look at how our policing is structured. The policing is a national function, and then we have it cascaded down to Metro Police and on the local level. I think what the Aninboesan case has shown us, and I was involved in that case as a commissioner, is that there are very limited leisure activities which local governments are responsible for, very limited way of integrating youth into programs. There's a huge problem with housing, and so there are and some of the issues are just bad basic service delivery on the local government level. So we need to improve service delivery, we need to look at housing, we need to look at the provision of leisure activities. And those are all the responsibilities of local government. So local government has a very important role to play. But I also think we need programs to train local government officials in gender, understanding gender needs and using what we call gender disaggregated data, which means you look at how conditions influence men and women differently. And I think there's a huge problem with not the lack of having a 50-50 implementation on local government level. 50-50 means that we have to have 50% women as local government officials. Now, we have done, as the Commission, a lot of research on this, and it's not happening. So just by excluding women from local government, we're already excluding them from the solutions that women need on a local government level.
Well, let's take the position, the top position of mayors. How many of our mayors in South Africa are female?
I don't know off the top of my head, but I would say 5% or less.
Which means we are not making good inroads in terms of gender equality.
No, not on those levels where people actually have power to implement policy and to have a very important impact on policy making. So, and it shows that very often the greatest resistance by men against women in government is on local government level. So that's where we have to make the change.
Do we have lessons to learn from other countries around the world? I mean, there are basically hundreds of mayors here today, city managers. Do we have something to learn from other countries? Is there any model country we need to look at?
Well, I think if we've listened to the papers this morning, there are very interesting things being done, not necessarily by women mayors, but by mayors who've looked at their cities and said, we have such a huge problem with violence. There was a paper on Medellin in Colombia where narco trafficking is a huge problem. They reduced their homicide rate from 380 in beginning of the 2000s to 48 now, which shows us that by the programs of social inclusion and building different infrastructure, they've changed and made a huge difference. And, you know, we can do that for women. So I think that just by looking at some of these papers today, we can learn a lot. And I'm sure they're going to be very interesting papers this afternoon by women who are looking at the safety for women in cities.
Thank you very much, Professor Amanda Holt from the University of Stellenbosch. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.